I don't know that I could identify what I think is the most important topic that a sermon could be about. The series that we have been looking at and talking about is why is evangelism so difficult from time to time? Why is it that we think that it's hard? And in this series, we've attempted to try to simplify that for you and to think about it together in a way that doesn't make it quite so challenging for us. And we've talked about some really important topics. We've talked about why it's so important that we reach the lost. We've talked about the fact that we have been instructed that it is a command, that it's not optional for us, it's something that we're supposed to do. We know that we have been instructed that we're supposed to take the gospel into all of the land, and we've looked at how to do that and why we should do that. We've even looked at a great example of someone who did that. Who found an opportunity to talk to one person. And how many times have we discussed that encounter between Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch? Last week we talked a little bit about God's instruction, example about sending workers into the vineyard all the time. Whether it's the example given early in life or late in life, but the vineyard being the world that we're supposed to go into the church is supposed to go into the world and do that. We talked a little bit about those who have been willing to do so. Those who were eager to say, look, I'm going to do this. And the examples that we have of those who have. This morning, I really debated whether or not I wanted to do this. I told Ben, son Ben, what I was going to be talking about this morning. And he said, I really don't like that song. It's a difficult thing to think about. It's a difficult phrase. And I think in some ways it's even harder to hear it. But the reason why we have to keep talking about it is that it is a matter of life and death. And in life and death situations, there is a degree of urgency. Yesterday, as we were headed to the hospital again to check on a little guy, came through the emergency department, had to drop something off of Lisa, and we were headed through. And just as we had walked in, they had called a code in the emergency room. And these otherwise calm medical professionals that you see walking about and just doing their thing, I see them now beginning to do it with urgency, and one young lady who's sprinting across the emergency room to grab some specific supplies to take into the room where the code was occurring. There was no time to waste. Why? Because it's a life and death situation. And when you and I think about what we're supposed to be considering as Christians, yes, we have a God-given responsibility, obligation, if you will, to share the good news. And not a single one of us are exempt from that responsibility. And I want us to finish the series this morning. Now, I got to thinking about that comment that that's really not even accurate. We're never going to stop talking about being evangelistic. It's going to stop being our emphasis this week. But the truth is that the hymn that Ben said, I really don't like that song, is what I'm going to center our worship around this morning. And as we begin, I'm going to ask you to sing this song with me. When in the better land, before the bar we stand, all right, we're going to start over. I have sung this thing 200 times this week and never messed it up until today. When in the better land, before the bar we stand, how deeply grieved our souls will be. If any lost from there should cry in deep despair, you never
me. You never mentioned him to me. You helped me not the light to see. You met me day by day and knew I was astray.
Supposed to teach one another and admonish one another in songs and hymns and spiritual songs, then what is it that this hymn is supposed to be teaching us? And I think that we know what it is. We know that there is an important message that we should get from this particular song. Look at what we just sang. When in the better land before the bar we stand, how deeply grieved our souls will be. We stop right there and think about that for a second. As Christians, I thought that was supposed to be an exciting time for us to stand before the bar. If any lost one there should cry in deep despair, you never mentioned him to me. Oh, let us spread the word where Aaron may be heard. Help groping souls the light to see, that yonder none may say, you showed me not the way, you never mentioned him to me. A few sweet words may guide a lost one to his side, or turn sad eyes on Calvary. So work as days go by, that yonder none may cry, you never mentioned him to me. And then the chorus, you never mentioned him to me. You helped me not the light to see. You met me day by day, and you knew I was astray. And yet you never mentioned him to me. I think this particular song is supposed to do a couple of things. One, it's supposed to remind us that there is going to be a judgment.
when in the better land before the bar we stand. Now that notion of the bar, you know, if we think about what a courtroom looks like, you know, may we, Your Honor, may we approach the bar, right? The bar is supposed to be where this judgment scene is being played out. And we're reminded, and Luke reminds us in Acts 17, that there was a time of ignorance that God would wink at, but now commands all men everywhere to repent because he has appointed a day on which he is going to judge the world. He didn't say might judge it. He said he's going to do it. And so when we think about it, what we've been singing is that it would be a great day, a bright day for some, and apparently it's going to be an incredibly sad day for all people or other people. But what we know is everybody's going to do it. Everybody. 2 Corinthians 5:10, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things that he's done in the body according to what he's done, whether it be good or bad. Everyone's going to go. And everybody's going to get something. Romans 14. Why do you judge your brother? Why do you show contempt for your brother? Because we will all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And Paul said, because it is written, every knee shall bow to me and every tongue will confess to God. And so each one will then give an account of himself to God. You've heard me say, there will be no atheist on the day of judgment. And how do we know? Because everyone is going to confess his name. Everyone is going to do so. Those who have been previously non-believers are going to meet their fate by acknowledging who he is. And in this song, there is this reminder of how deeply grieved our souls may be. And when we think about it, the souls of people that we come in contact with every day ought to be a source of concern for us. And that's what the song is trying to get us to think about. It will be a time of grieving if there are souls present that day that described as being lost. A terrible that will be, because we know what the scripture says will be their eternal destiny if that occurs. And it's a conclusion that most are going to wind up on the wrong side. Don't shoot the messenger. Jesus said, many are called, but few are chosen. In Matthew 7, we talk about the wide way and the broad gate that leads to destruction. With apologies to Robert Frost, that will be the road more traveled. That is the one that we're going to see. Way too many people are going to take. Because when Jesus describes that scene, destruction is described as being something where many will wind up. The good news is that not all are going to be lost, and we know there are good people out there. Listen, don't get hardened. Don't get to the point where you see so much bad going on in the world. You see so many evil people in the world. Don't get hardened thinking no one cares. There are still people who are looking. Amen? We've got to try to figure out what we're supposed to do. And we've got to get busy doing it. And whether we use the example of Cornelius, who was so excited to hear the message preached that he gathers his whole household together so they'll be there for it, or the Ethiopian eunuch who was so excited to have somebody stop and teach him what he could not understand. And we know that there are many descriptions, particularly in the book of Acts. So many people who were excited to hear the word, the good news, the truth, and who responded appropriately. And so while there will be some who will be deeply grieved, here's the thing that I've tried to get us to think about in the series. Can we simplify the task by saying, one, the message is really not that difficult that we need to share, And it's one that you have probably known since the day before you were baptized. And the task becomes much easier when we recognize that you don't have to convert all of Murray County or Williamson County. Start with one. And it's scriptural. It's what we are learning from the passages that tell us how exciting it is in heaven when there's one convert, one person. And what we need to be thinking about is, do we see that one person with the appropriate level of urgency that we ought to have? Because 2 Corinthians 5 says, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, Paul said, we persuade men because we know what the end is going to look like. As I watched particularly one young lady yesterday who put her head down and sprinted through the nursing station and went in and was grabbing supplies and ran back to the room, I thought, there's urgency. That's what it looks like. That's what you do when somebody's life is on the line. That's what how you have to respond. And you and I are told that that's happening. Colossians 1 says, him we preach, Paul told the church, warning every man and teaching every man in the wisdom that we may present the man who is perfect, Christ Jesus. That's what we're supposed to be sharing. That's your message. You're looking for your first big sermon outline. There it is. Jesus left heaven, came to earth, was persecuted, died on our behalf, was resurrected, and he wants you and I to come be with him eternally. There's your sermon. And so what we have to think about is that this song is reminding us that is that we have to think about what that judgment scene is going to look like. I don't know whether or not in that line, if I look behind me or next to me and see people that I know, I don't know that. But it would be a very difficult thing to look and see people that you know you have seen every day. You never took the time to try to do anything. You know, when in Acts 20, when Paul is talking to the Ephesian elders, it's a great lesson there. He said, I have tried not to withhold anything from you. I've shunned not to declare unto you the whole counsel of God. He said, well, Paul had that ability and I don't. I don't either. But we have the ability to tell them who Christ was and what he did and why it matters and why it's going to matter to them. And Paul said, look, I've come in the place of some interesting audiences. The Hebrew of Hebrews is sent to the Gentiles. I've become all things to all men that by any means some might be saved. And you and I have to think about how we're going to do that. The second verse encourages us in that song that we need to spread the word. Spread the word wherever it can be heard. And it's a command that we are supposed to be doing everything we can to find those people who are out there, and it is our responsibility. And I've actually heard someone attempt to argue that the Great Commission was given to the apostles, not me. I've heard that argued. And you know what? It was given to the apostles. You know what? There are a lot of things that are given in Scripture that was for somebody else that you and I were supposed to take to heart, live it out. Because when we find, sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and be ready to give an answer to all those who ask, that's you and me. And part of that means that we're supposed to do, that picture that you saw from the caption of Ezekiel 33, that's supposed to be the text for which this song was written. And it talks about our responsibility to teach, to warn, to cajole, to encourage, to pray with those who will be held accountable. But the truth is, if we don't do that, you and I will be held accountable. And so we have to do this. And we're supposed to help groping souls see the light. Did you catch that in the song? Groping souls. There are a lot of people out there who I guess we could describe as being groping souls. You know, groping souls are those, here's the definition for groping. Moving or going about clumsily or hesitantly, stumbling. Showing or reflecting a desire to understand, especially something that proves puzzling. There are people who are wandering around clumsily trying to find out what the real truth is. I'm not a fan of a couple of particular social media outlets, but one of them that discusses a lot of things going on in Colombia, I follow from time to time. And it has become fascinating to me how many times in the last month or so that somebody has posted a note on there that says, "We're looking for a church to attend. Can you recommend something?" There's still some people looking. There's still some people that want to do it. Lisa and I had an occasion where we drove up past Joanne and the Smithson's house recently and was looking at those houses being built over there. How many new housing units are being built within 2 miles of the church building? I happen to know the answer to that. It's over 1,000. Close to 2,000. So how many people are going to be in our back door looking for a church? And I hope they're looking for more than that. I hope they're looking for a Savior as well. But we're told that Jesus said, in Him was life, and in Him was the light of men. And that light is the light that they're groping to try to find. How hard is it to introduce people to the light? I'm the light of the world. If you follow me and not walk in darkness, but you will have the light of life. If they're groping the light to see and Jesus is the light, we ought to be sharing the light with them. And thinking, how can we do that? We've been talking about it over and over again, but pretty simply two ways. One is that we're supposed to be the example. As one who is walking in the light, then in the midst of a crooked or perverse generation, that we're supposed to be the one who are shining as lights in the world. And we need to recognize that there are people who are watching. They are watching. I have a little one sitting over there that hasn't turned 4 yet. And I am continually amazed at things she has seen and what she remembers, like the t-shirt I was wearing to her birthday party 2 years ago. You think people aren't paying attention? You think they don't know what you're like and what you're doing? And that yonder none may say, "You showed me not the way." You never mentioned Him. Why is that hard? Well, it's hard because we don't know if they're groping or not. We don't know if they're looking or not. So the best way to deal with that is to go ahead and mention Him and tell them so that they can recognize. And sometimes, as the song says, all it takes is a little sweetness. Sometimes that's all it takes to turn somebody in the right direction. It is by being the kind of example we're supposed to be and thinking about how we talk to other people and what may be what they need to hear. That our speech is to be like grace seasoned with salt, and a word fitly spoken is like apples of gold in settings of silver. I've always loved that phrase and never completely had a picture in my mind of just how wonderful that would be. And so what we need to think about is that our quest really isn't to win some sort of a battle. Our quest is to win a soul. You know, break it down. Don't let it overwhelm. And in this world, we're supposed to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. So go about it in a smart manner, but go about it with a heart that remains pure and tender. And then the song says, or just get to turn sad eyes to Calvary. Never forget what Calvary means. Never forget what that message is. Paul said, I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. If you can't come up with any other topic to discuss, but just steal that verse, I'm sure Paul won't care if we plagiarize. I'm determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. God forbid that I should boast in anything else. Paul was trying to keep it very, very simple. But I think this is the part of the song that I have a really particularly hard time with. So, work as days go by. It reminds us that there is going to be an end. The time is going to come. We're supposed to be ready. We're supposed to stay ready. We're supposed to be active. We're supposed to be there all the way to the end. Remember what that 11th hour worker got paid? And so we need to work while we can, while we have the opportunity. Brother John, I can't imagine you spending 29 years with this group. But it is amazing to me how fast the days go by. That it seems like just yesterday that I got a call from some elders that said, we'd like you to come and try out. Okay. And the days seem to have flown by in doing so. But as the days go by, we need to make sure that on that day in judgment, that no one can cry, you never mentioned him to me. That chorus is a constant reminder. Those people that we see every day. You saw me day by day and you knew I was astray. Who we see every day. You know who they are. And some of them you don't like seeing. Ever, much less every day. Still the soul is saved. Still the most important task that you will be given this side of heaven. The truth is, there may be among those people, these aren't strangers, these are people that you see every day. These are people you know. These are people that you really should think about, and more than that, you should care about. And use your relationship. You know, they talk about different techniques for evangelism, and I've told you over and over again, I personally believe that the concept of friendship evangelism is the most effective. Those people with whom you are friends, you already have a relationship, those are the people that you should have the greatest opportunity to reach. Don't quit trying. Look for teachable moments. Remember in John 4 why Jesus was criticized? He walked up and he spoke to a Gentile. He did a lot more than that. He spoke to a woman in public in the daytime, who, by the way, had less than a favorable reputation. Jesus saw her as an opportunity. He saw her as somebody who needed something that he could meet. We can't let it be said of us that you never mentioned him to me. That would be an incredibly sad day if that person does that. And we didn't even try. We consider the command that we are given, not just for ourselves, but the command that you and I are supposed to fulfill is supposed to be because of other people too. That's why we gather together. It's not just about you. Even though we want you to come and get your tank filled when we worship together, you need to be here to admonish others unto love and to good works. And that's why it's important that you attend. It's not just about me. It's about all of us and what we're supposed to do and why we've got to get it done. Isn't there somebody that you care enough about that you would share the good news? And somebody who did it for you. You remember who it was? I bet you do. I'll bet you, if I were to ask every person in this room who's a Christian, who was the one person that you look back about and think about who probably did more to help you someday become a Christian than anybody else? I know who it was. And he was 6'7" and weighed almost 250 pounds. And when I see Ron Estes to this day, I thank him for asking me to come play softball on the church team. He knew it would get me to church. Who did you that favor? Who was it? Do you, like Paul, consider yourself a debtor? He said, I am a debtor to the Greeks, to the barbarians, to both the wise and the unwise. He said, there are so many people that I have a debt to. You and I are debtors. And there's somebody out there that we need to be sharing this with. And when we see this psalm, and as hard as I think it is sometimes to sing, what it's supposed to do is it's supposed to teach us. It's supposed to admonish us. It gives you this judgment scene, and it's hard to think about, and it's hard to hear. But to think about this, imagine you or I standing before God giving an account of our life, and it's not a matter of you hearing somebody say, you never mentioned him to me. It's about God saying, you never mentioned me to him. We can't do that. Evangelism doesn't have to be terrifying. It needs to grab our hearts. We need to understand what's in store for us as Christians, and we need to share that. Think about your own kids and grandkids, moms and dads, people that you love so much that you would do absolutely anything for them. Do we love them enough to share with them eternity? This morning, if you have a need to respond to the gospel invitation, we're going to give you another chance to do that. I can't give you a personal guarantee that you will get another opportunity after this one. I hope you do. If you don't respond, and I'll keep praying for you, and I'll keep encouraging you. But my question is, what else do we need to say? How much do we need to love? How much do we need to care? I don't want you to stand at judgment and say, you never mentioned him to me, and I don't want God to say, you never mentioned me to him. And so here's your opportunity. And since most of us are Christians, if you don't do anything today but ask God to help you do better with this, that would be a great start. If we need to help you, if we need to pray for you for strength, for conviction, for forgiveness, we'll do that. Maybe there's just something that's got you worried. We'll be happy to pray for you in that regard. If there's anything we can do to help you publicly, we invite you to stand and come as we sing this song.